in the words of the one we're here today to remember and celebrate, welcome home. Donald Frederick Crowe was a special man to us all. A dad, a husband, a brother-in-law, an uncle, a song leader, a church board member, church treasurer, missions delegate, prayer warrior, and a faithful friend. He faithfully told everyone at the front doors of the church, welcome home, with such heartfelt love that every person, including myself, felt immediately like we were home. And it's one of the reasons many of us kept coming. So we put it on the wall as you walked in, put that on the wall several years ago. And as we see those words, welcome home, on the front foyer there, we're forever reminded of Don's love for each one of us and his love for God and our love for each other. Will you join me in prayer? Lord, we are so thankful today for the life of Don Crowe. God, we're so thankful for how he impacted each one of us. And Lord, this is really hard, and we miss him. And we ask that your peace be with Dolores and Terry and Bob and Mike and Don and Jim and Sue and all of the family members here today and watching online. And be with this church family who is deeply grieving. Comfort each heart. And thank you that you hold every tear we cry in a bottle. And you know and understand how our hearts grieve. But we thank you today that we do not grieve without hope. As we know, Don is forever with you. In Jesus' name, amen. During Don's last few minutes on earth, I had the honor to be with him during that time at St. Vincent's Hospital in Portland, and I read these scriptures over him that I'll tell you a little bit more about what happened at the end of the service. One scripture was John chapter 11, verses 25 and 26. Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me shall live even if he dies. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die." Do you believe this? John 14, 1 through 6, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you so. For I go there to prepare a place for you. And if I go there and prepare a place for you, I will come back and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may also be. And you know the way to where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" And Jesus said to him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me." In 1 Corinthians 16, 50 through 57, "Now I say this, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For this perishable must put on the imperishable, and this mortal must put on immortality. But when this perishable will have put on the imperishable, and this mortal will have put on immortality, then will come about the saying that is written, 'Death is swallowed up in victory.' O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
In Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You have anointed my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and loving kindness will follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever, forever. Well, Dawn always woke up with a song. And if we sang all the songs Dawn woke up with, we'd be here all day. Actually, probably for all eternity. So if you have the strength to stand, would you stand with me as we sing a couple of Dawn's favorites?
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God. Born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song. Praising our Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission.
And Don did praise the Lord all day and all night. He always had a song. We sang this song with Dolores and Terry the day he died. And Don tried to sing it with us. Amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
John loved that song. He loved them all. And I pray today it is well with your soul. Terry's going to come and share the eulogy, and you can be seated. Terry is the oldest of all the kids. Yeah.
Thank you all for coming. Special memories. Donald Frederick Crow. He was born May 4th, 1934, and passed away October 29th, 2023. Donald Frederick Crow was born in Florence, Alabama, to James Herschel Crow and Emma Pamelia Elizabeth Ann Holly Crow. Yeah. He was the fourth of six children, James Herschel Jr., Margaret Dolores, Emma Dean, Mary Cornelius, and Esther Ruth. His family later moved to Cuna, Idaho when he was 12 years old, which, if I did my calculations right, was 1946. Don excelled, in my memory, Don excelled in the Cuna Cavemen football team by setting the school record for the most yards gained by a fullback, which was just recently broken, if I understand that correctly. He was also pretty good in track. Now I lost my place. He graduated from high school in 1952 and went to work for Western Electric as a telephone equipment installer, if I have that right, little brother, until he retired in 1984. When Don was 18 years old, this is my favorite part of the story, when Don was 18 years old, he married Dolores May Purdom, age 17, on June 19, 1953. My favorite part is here. After having to obtain written permission from her parents, Robert and Gladys Purdom, they were married 70 years. They moved to Phoenix, Arizona in 1955 and raised six children. Terrace Duane, which I didn't really want to say that out loud. But since I did, Robert James, Michael Dennis, Donald Ernest, James David, and last but not least, Susan Marie. They attended the Alzona Westdale, turned out to be the Westdale Church, they changed their name, Church of the Nazarene, and began his lifelong ministry of leading worship or leading music. He also joined a gospel quartet singing, and they played the upright bass, which I remember that but forgot. They moved to Oregon in 1994 and then on to Glen Eden Beach in 2000 and became active in the Lincoln City Church of the Nazarene by leading worship, serving on the board, along with many other volunteer responsibilities. His recent favorite saying was, "Speak softly and carry a big stick." This cane that one of his best friends, Skip, made and gave it to him. He went out and found it and whittled it down, and it's pretty special. Dad was proud of it. And I remember every time we'd go to Burger King, anybody that walked in the door, he'd walk up to him and speak softly and carry a big stick. Anyway, he was also best known to the church by his church family by stating, "Welcome home" to everyone who walked in the door. And a little bit to add there were several people that came and delivered food. By the way, we really appreciated that. But with tears in their eyes would explain that that's the reason why they're still going to this church. So that's pretty special. Don was preceded in death by his parents, all of his siblings, his granddaughter Rachel, and his great-granddaughter Maxine. He's survived by his wife Dolores, his children, Terrace, who's married to Cheryl, lives in Colorado Springs, Colorado, Robert and Karen, who's living in Glendale, Arizona, Michael and Johnny in Las Vegas, Nevada, Donald and Julie live in Phoenix, Arizona, and James and Debbie lives in Phoenix, Arizona, and last but not least, Susan, who lives in Glen Eden Beach, Oregon, as well as 18 grandchildren and 16 great-grandchildren.
So stay right there, Terry.
That's right.
I want to invite the church board to come up. At this time, the church board has a special presentation. You know, when I got here as pastor 13 years ago, Don was on the board, and he had been on the board long before I got here. Had many, many roles in the church, and played a special part in our church, and the church board wants to honor him today.
This is a certificate of recognition to Don Crow in in memory of Don Crow, Lincoln City Church of the Nazarene has donated $1,000 to the Wesleyan Investment Foundation, payment of the Church of the Church loan building. We are thankful for Don's service to the Lord and to his church. Don was deeply loved, and he loved deeply.
So for those of you that aren't aware, and you never think about it, even a church is a business, and it has to operate like a business. It pays bills, it takes in money, it takes in tithes and offerings. And for those of you that don't know me, I'm Dave Westgate. I took over as church treasurer when Don just could no longer do it anymore about 2.5, 3 years ago. And I realized at that point, and I saw at that point, the stacks of paperwork that he went through. He sat at his dining room table for hours and hours and hours doing paperwork just to keep this church running. He was very concerned about keeping the business of this church in order, that there was money in the bank, that the bills were paid, and that the building loan was paid. I've taken it over now, and I respect him greatly for all the work that he did, although I did computerize it. It still takes hours and hours and hours at some point. So we loved Don, and we loved him for everything that he did.
The best for the last for the best. The first words that my husband and I heard when we walked through those doors out there was, "Welcome home." Don has since become a very close friend. The first time that I was elected on the board, him and I would drive into board meeting together, and he would talk about how he prayed for his wife, Dolores, to be healed because he loved her so much, and that was the gist of our conversation, was how we could pray together for her. And so over the years, with being on the board together, we got pretty close. So, yes, I loved him, and I'm going to continue to love him. But he's still at work in my home. My husband has dementia, and my husband has mellowed out a great deal since Don's death. So he's definitely at work in my home.
Oh, thank you. Thank you guys so much. Yeah, Don moved from Alabama to what he said was God's country when he was 12 years old with his family, moved to Nampa, Idaho, and soon after that moved to Cuna, Idaho. And he called himself a Cuna caveman. I said, "Well, Don, I've been down into the Cuna caves," and he thought that was pretty cool. But when he moved there, they moved around the corner from the Purdom Farm. And there was a sweet gal there, just a young teenager, Dolores. And Dolores would go and sit in the bleachers at the football games with Mary and watch Don play football, and they were cheering him on. And of course, they quickly fell in love, and pretty special, their 70-year marriage. You know, the boys remember growing up and fishing with Dad. They remember they usually didn't catch anything, but they could see those fish there, and they were trying to figure out what could lure and entice the fish to get on the hooks, but often it didn't work. And so the boys would kind of give up, and they'd go downstream and go fishing, or go swimming, excuse me. Even more than fishing, Don was a hunter, and he shot a couple of deer. And he was an excellent shooter for duck hunting. He loved that. His son Bob remembered one time they were camping, and they had to cross a cement bridge to get there. But the river flooded, and the bridge flooded, and so they extended their camping trip an extra couple days before they could cross the bridge. And as a kid, Terry played baseball. And he was a pretty good catcher, but wasn't quite a good hitter. But his dad was his biggest cheerleader, cheering him on right there at the games. Well, Don, we know, worked for the telephone company most of his life, and he moved all over kind of the western half of the United States. I remember him sharing about Colorado and New Mexico and working in Montana and Nevada and Utah and Arizona and all over the place. And I love that Bob, his second son here, still works for the same phone company. Well, Don was a huge cheerleader to every pastor he ever had. Ray Frank was one of his pastors in Carefree, Arizona. And it bothered Pastor Ray that Don would fall asleep during church. And so they invited Pastor Ray over for lunch after the service, and they were watching a football game. And it was the Broncos versus the Cowboys. And it was a very close game, and everybody screaming and shouting and rooting back and forth, and the score was so close, and they're in the final quarter, and Pastor Ray is so excited, and he's really into the game, and they were all very, very loud, and they look over, and Don's fast asleep. So it didn't bother Pastor Ray anymore that Don fell asleep during his sermons. And for the record, I think Don only fell asleep to one or two of mine. So over 13 years, that's pretty good. Well, when Mount St. Helens erupted, there was an IMAX show of that eruption. And so they went to the IMAX theater to watch this incredible thing with the seats rumbling, you know, and the loud sounds with those great speakers. And they watched it in the IMAX 5 or 6 times, and every single time Don fell asleep. And so finally, Sue said, by about the 7th time, they had watched it at home, and Don stayed awake the whole time. Well, Bob's first memory of having a black and white television was Don going to the Cat's Deli and getting pastrami sandwiches on Kaiser onion rolls with sauerkraut. And apparently all the Crow men loved this pastrami sandwich and watching the games together. Well, Don often fell asleep during those games. If he had a game playing at home, Sue remembers if she tried to change the channel, he would immediately wake up and get mad. And, well, he never really got mad, but anyway, it kind of drove Sue crazy if she wanted to watch something else while Dad was asleep. And so later in life, he started watching the game with the mute on, and so Sue could easily change the channel. Well, Don was really generous with his time in picking people up for church. The whole family remembers he drove a church bus and pick kids up for church. Sometimes he drove the Ford station wagon, cramming kids in there, picking up more kids. And more recently, he drove Skip, who was a blind man from our church. He'd drive all the way to the end of M&N Road, which was about an hour round trip to go pick Skip up every morning and after church, an hour round trip to go take him home. He did that for 8 years. And his vehicle was always dirty. And he says, oh, don't worry about it. It's just Skip dirt. And he never complained. And he always said, it was my pleasure. Yep, well, Skip made Don a cane, as Terry shared with us. It's down here. And Skip went into the woods, found an alder tree, and spent hours and months carving this special cane for his buddy Don. And Don loved going to Burger King, walking in the doors, getting everyone's attention, saying, speak softly and carry a big stick. So, yes, as far back as Terry could remember, Don led worship. He spent the whole week going through songs and sometimes changing the songs before Sunday as the Lord would direct him. And Don always woke up with a song. And he would, we had a little game every Sunday morning. He'd come in and he'd try to stump me with a song he thought I wouldn't know. And he only really stumped me a couple times with songs from like the 20s and 30s that he knew, but I'd stump him with some of the newer music and we had a great time. But we'd often just burst into song, singing duets out in the foyer or sometimes in here, just worshiping the Lord. Well, when I came here as pastor, almost 13 years ago now, there were 12 people in this church. And one of them was Don. And as you heard, he was the church treasurer, and he spent hours poring over the books and had binders after binder after binder as he did it all by hand. And one day he called me and he said, "Well, Pastor, I'm 4 cents off." And he spent hours more to find those 4 cents. Well, our little church of 12 people, we needed a miracle. And all 12 of us felt like we should do something for the community. The community at that time needed a preschool. And for us in our little church to start a preschool, we needed more room in our church to do that. And so we figured out we could add on to the church, but we would need a $160,000 loan to do that. And our little 12 people, that was a bit scary. You know, because the church had only brought in of like $49,000 the whole year prior. And for our treasurer, Don, that was really scary. And we finally found, we had six banks turn us down, but the seventh bank, the Wesleyan Investment Foundation, said, "Well, we'll loan you the money if you can raise $25,000 in good faith." And so we had a miracle month, and we were praying, you know, "God, help us to raise like half of what we brought in the whole year prior." And anyway, we were praying about that, and Don came to me. He was really troubled. He said, "You know, I'm on a fixed income. I don't know what I can give, but I know I want to give something, so will you just join me in prayer about what I can do?" And that week he came back and he was so excited. He says, "A piece of my property in Arizona just sold, and I'm able to give it." He had a, you know, a nice check there to contribute. And in that month, we raised $49,000 in cash to offset our building loan. Now we're under $95,000 on that loan. All glory to God. Yes. Well, every Sunday during that miracle month, Don would get up and he'd sing, "I believe in miracles. I've seen a soul set free. Miraculous, the change in one redeemed through Calvary. I've seen the lily push its way up through the stubborn sod. I believe in miracles, for I believe in God." And he'd usually end that song in tears. And then he'd say, "Wow, look at what God is doing." So excited. Well, every board meeting, Don was so thrilled as we'd hear the report of that building loan going down, and he'd say, "Oh, praise God." Don loved miracles. One of the miracles he loved in the Bible was the miracle of Lazarus rising from the dead. And he'd say, "Pastor, do you know why Jesus says, 'Lazarus, come forth'? Because if he would have just said, 'Come forth,' all the dead would have come out of their tombs." Well, Don would often forget the words to a song, but that was no problem, as he just made up new words. And as his hearing grew worse, he would stand right here beside me, and he could no longer hear the keyboard. And so he decided he would be a faithful congregant, and he sat right there in that empty chair because all three speakers were facing right there so he could hear really good. And he started reading my lips to know when to come in, because sometimes it was still hard to hear. And he read everybody's lips. In fact, when he had his heart attack October 25th of 2020, Sue and Dolores and I were in the Corvallis Hospital, and they did some surgery, and it was pretty cool because they welcomed us back to the control room to watch the instant replay of how they fixed Don's heart. And it was amazing to watch that. And anyway, I went to visit Don, and of course it was during the time of wearing masks. And I was talking really loud, but Don would say, "Pastor, I can't understand you. Take your mask off." Because I then realized how much He had become dependent on reading lips. Well, Don led worship for us Sunday night for our Otis Church and for our Dorchester Church. We had three churches going all at once, and he led worship all three of those times, and he would say, "It is my pleasure." Yep. He was friends with everybody. It was really, really cool. Well, one time we borrowed the Newport Naz's church van because we were trying to figure out what to do for our carpeting, and the Seaside Church had said, "Well, you know, we have this really cool kind of polished cement floor. We'd love for you to come check it out." So we borrowed this church van, and on our way home, Don was riding shotgun with me, and we came just past the overlook, and we're going down the hill, and there was a mama deer and two baby deer. And Don said, "Deer!" And I'm driving, and I put on the brakes. I think everybody woke up. And Don called it another miracle as we somehow, this church van, squeezed through mama deer and one of the babies on my left, and the other baby was on our right. And they didn't touch the Newport Naz church van, praise God. But I was thankful Don was awake. Yes. Well, as everyone in this church can contribute, Don said, "Welcome home." Right? There was such care in how he said it. He was faithful to do that. He was here every Sunday, at least by 9:30. We started at 10. At 9 o'clock, he was Sue's alarm clock, and he'd knock on Sue's door and say, "It's 9 o'clock. Sue, it's 9:02. It's time to go." Right? Well, Don would come in, he'd get his black coffee, and he'd say, "Welcome home," to everyone who walked in the doors. During our fire relief time, we were serving over 1,000 people who lost their homes in the Otis fires, and Don came down to greet people who were coming in, and he fell, actually right there in front of the men's room, and he broke his nose, and he filled the whole carpet square up with blood. He was really concerned about the carpet, and we were really concerned about him, and I said, "Well, Don, will you please start using a walker when you come to church?" And so he did, and he grew more stable over time, and as time went on, he'd go and he'd park his walker, and then he'd walk all over the church. But I found out just about a month ago, he brought his walker just to please me. Well, Don really wanted me to meet his baby girl, who was attending Newport Naz. And shortly after I became pastor, we went, Don and Dolores and Sue and I and Bob and Grace, we all went to Alaska on a cruise together with Newport Naz. And Don drove us up to Seattle. His baby girl, Sue, who I found out is older than I am, was telling her dad, giving her dad directions. "Dad, turn left." And Don would turn right. "Dad, go straight." And he would turn left. He couldn't hear his baby girl's directions. And so we drove all over Seattle for about 3 hours. I don't think we ever found our port, but we saw it from a distance. And Don was totally oblivious to all the cars honking at him. And Uncle Bob's thumbs, remember the thumbs, they were just going really hard and strong. I thought, he's going to rub those thumbs right off. And Uncle Bob Deem decided we were going to hire a van to get us to the port the next day, and we got there in 10 minutes. Well, because Don called Sue his baby girl, it didn't bother me that he called me little girl. And every Sunday after church on his way out, he would say, "I love you, little girl, but Jesus loves you more." It didn't matter if someone was homeless who walked in or a district superintendent, he told everybody, "She's not available." Don was one of my biggest fans. He was on the church board long before I arrived 13 years ago and has been on the church board most of the last 13 years. one of his roles was pastoral support, and so he'd always ask me nearly every week, how's your car running? You know, are there any problems at the parsonage? And one day I said, well, yeah, the sink in my bathroom is leaking. And he says, oh, okay, no problem. And he came over with this big washer that I guess was bigger than what was needed. And the sink turned on, but it turned on really hard. So I really developed good muscles in my left hand turning that water on. One time the bathroom shower was leaking, and Keith came over and fixed it. And Don came over to support and encourage Keith in his walk with the Lord and encourage him, this unchurched man. And then every year, Don and Dolores came over. As I needed my piano tuned, he would go and meet the piano tuner and tell him about his sister who could make the piano sing. And really, really special that he did that every year. Well, Don and I often talked about heaven and our final moments here on earth. And we talked about lots of different people in our church and other people who had died and how so many of them lifted up their hands when they saw Jesus. And they were like ready to go. And so on October 24th of this year, when Don had a major stroke, he was lifting up his hand and Sue said, not yet, Dad, not yet. I'm not ready. But I know he was seeing Jesus. You know, a couple months ago, I sensed the Lord saying, Kelly, there's more sides to me that you haven't seen yet. And I said, well, Lord, I'd love to know another aspect of you. And what I didn't know is that that would happen when Don went home to be with Jesus. It was incredibly special for me to be there with him in the hospital. The family was hungry. It had been a long day, and they went to go get some dinner. And I said, well, I'll just stay with Don. And I was reading the scriptures that I read to you earlier today. And as I was reading these scriptures, first of all, I noticed this large presence of the Lord came in and filled the room. And it was just huge. And then I'm noticing Don is mouthing the words with me. Where, oh, death, is your victory? Where is your sting? Death has been swallowed up in victory. And this was the most we had seen Don really respond in several days. And at the same time, I felt like this shadow came over me. And I thought, well, that's kind of strange. I didn't know what to make of that. And here last week, I was just asking the Lord. I was talking to him about that. I said, Lord, I've been with many people when they've died, but it's always been light. What's the deal with this shadow? And the Lord reminded me of Psalm 91:1, he who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. And I believe that it was the Lord Almighty who came to get Don. And the power, the resurrection power of the Lord was so strong, he had to put me in the shadow so I didn't go too. That's how strong it was. And I said, you know, Jesus, it's really strange. Here, I read these scriptures over Don, and he said, at that time, I felt like Jesus and the angels just stood at attention to the word of God. Like all the words came alive. You know, walking through the valley of the shadow of death and dwelling in the house of the Lord forever, like every word started to live and jump off the pages. And it was like all of heaven stood at attention at the word of God. And I just, it was like this holy moment. And I started praying over Don. And I thanked God for Don's faithfulness to God, for God's faithfulness to Don. I thanked God for every day Don prayed for me. He prayed for all of you by name every day. It was special. was special, and as I was praying, and I said, and God, thank you that Dolores is taken care of, and that Don no longer needs to worry, I felt like his spirit left in that moment. And I finished up with a couple of sentences, in Jesus' name, amen. And he was gone. And it was such a holy and sacred moment. It's reminded of Psalm 116:15, how precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. You know, everything we do for the Lord is not in vain. Jesus is real. He's real. And one day, it will be worth it all when we see Jesus. So here's the important question. And it's a question that Don thought was so important. He wanted everybody to have a clear answer in their heart and mind. But do you know for certain that if you died today, you'd go to heaven? Or is that something you're still working on? You know, the Bible says all of us have sinned and we all fall short of the glory of God, and not one of us can save ourselves by our good works. You know, it's only by the grace of Jesus. It's by the grace of the Lord when we repent of our sins and ask forgiveness that Jesus will cleanse us of all of our sins. He'll put his robes of righteousness on us, that someday, when we take our last breath on earth, we'll be taking our first breath in heaven. You know, maybe there's someone here today who doesn't know Jesus, but longs to hear the words, "Welcome home." Right? Well, today might be the best day of your life, because a relationship with Jesus can start today. Revelation 3:20 says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. And if anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with him and he with me." Will you pray with me? Well, Lord Jesus, I am so thankful for Don's life and his ministry. God, we are so thankful today for how Don served you, and he loved each one of us. God, we thank you for his family, and we pray you would be especially close to each one. Lord, we thank you for his 70 years of marriage to Dolores, and all six of his kids, and his grandkids, and his great-grandkids, and his nieces and nephews, and double cousins, and church family, and on, Lord, he ministered so much to each one of us, and what a testament to his life that we're all here today. Lord, we thank you for being a friend to Don Crow, and that he was a friend to you. The two, God, you were so close to Don. And Lord, I just pray that if anybody here today wants to be a friend of God, wants to know for certain they're going to heaven, Lord, right now in our hearts we just say, "I'm sorry for my sins. I repent. I ask you to forgive me and cleanse my heart. I ask you to fill my heart and life. I want you to lead me. Be my Lord and Savior. And I want to follow you all the days of my life." And with every head bowed and eye closed, if you just prayed that with me today, would you just make eye contact with me? Right now, yes. 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 Anybody else? Don't want to miss anybody. Yes. Lord Jesus, we just thank you. We thank you, God, of how Don's life impacted our lives. We're thankful for his love for you and his love for us, and how he showed us how to have that relationship with you that's real and personal. God, I thank you for these seven people today who have given their hearts to Jesus. And I just pray it would be such a close and personal relationship. And Lord, for all of us who've known you for maybe all of our lives, Lord, I pray you show us a different side of yourself that we could know you more. Lord, we'll be careful to give you all the praise. You're a good and faithful God, and we love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. At this time, we're going to watch a slideshow.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my side. Angels descending, ring from above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day. Submission, all is at rest. I and my Savior am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with God's goodness, lost in his love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Praising my Savior all the day.
Saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood, His mercy rains, unending love, amazing promise good to me. His word, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains are
His last Sunday here, he was walking with his walker with one hand, carrying the coffee with the other. It's the picture down front, happy as could be. And that Sunday he told me, "You tell all my boys and my daughter how proud I am of each and every one of them." I think he knew he was going to see Jesus long before we did. Pretty special. Well, this time we're going to open up the microphone, and we have a microphone down here, or you can come up here wherever you're comfortable, but we know there's a lot of people who want to share, so maybe just stick to one story if you can, but come and share. I'm sure it would encourage the family, and maybe there's some family who wants to come. Patricia. Okay.
Yes, you got it. Well, my name is Patricia Purdom, and I am married to Stephen Purdom, who is one of eight children from Ernest and Mary Purdom. And Mary is Don's sister, and I use it in present tense because they are now, as I speak, up in heaven rejoicing. Just think of it, how amazing that is. A year ago, God answered many prayers, and he gave me a new kidney. And so in that, it has emboldened me to get up in front of people and speak like I am. Otherwise, I would be the class clown at the back of the class. Anyway, so 13 years ago, Kelly's first Sunday, my husband brought me over here to introduce me to his family. And as he parked the car, I walked in, and Don turned and said, "Welcome home." Shaking my hand, looking over my shoulder, he saw Stephen. And so then Stephen introduced me as his wife, and Uncle Don then turned around and said, "Welcome home, little sister, welcome home." So I want you all on the count of three to say welcome home, okay, as loud as you can. One, two, three. Welcome home, Don. Welcome home.
Amen.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
And I thought you guys were just part of the church family. I said, where did your relatives go when they weren't here the next Sunday? But got to know you over time. It's good. Someone else, come and share. Here Jean comes.
I don't have a whole lot to read, but the first time I came here, I was about 6-7 years ago. I was brought in here by a friend, and I've been to a lot of different churches. I walked in through the door, and this man was standing there, and he says, with a warm smile on his face, "Welcome home, welcome home," as he handed me the bulletin. I was really in awe of it. Wow, what a welcome, warm presentation, reception that was to me, and I still marvel at it. I always think back on it. When we were here at church, we would have a potluck, and no matter where in the room you were sitting, you could hear his laugh, look his way, and see his cheery smile. I found him as a loving person and a very funny, happy man, always upbeat, making funny jokes, and making others laugh and smile. Once a week, we would meet, as Kelly would say, at Dorchester, where we would serve lunch for the residents who lived there. And we would have a small group of people come to our church service. Don would lead us in singing. What a great tune he would carry. While we were all eating lunch at Dorchester, the subject came up about rapture, how we would all be caught up in the sky and changed into our new heavenly bodies. Don said to the effect that if other people on earth wasn't paying attention in what's going on, then watch out below, for something just might hit you on the head very hard, like Jean's false leg. I have a prosthetic. And he would look down like this, you know, and say, "It's going to hit you." Bam, and it would hit you. We all had a good laugh from that. I will remember this always. I won't forget my friend Don. May your body rest in peace as your spirit rejoices in heaven with friends and family, and God saying, "Welcome home." My thoughts and prayers are with all of you. I may not know you all, but God knows you. He will handle it, and Godspeed and God bless you. Oh, that's Kelly's. Got one more. Matthew 5:4, "Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. And blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God." Welcome home, fine and faithful servant, is what God has said to Dawn.
Thank you, Jean. Someone else.
I don't share a story. I've shared it with a couple of the family already, but I want everybody to hear it. It's my rock story.
Okay.
I'm going to climb up there again.
All right. You go, Roberta.
But Don would always say to my husband, Jack, I threw a rock at you. Did you get it? I hope I didn't break a window. Jack would say, yeah, I got it. I threw it back at you. Didn't you get it? No, I haven't seen it yet. And this has been on and on every week. And so finally, my husband, Jack, he picked out a rock out of our yard, a plain old rock, brought it to church, and said to Don, here's the rock that you've been throwing at me. And so Don put that rock in his walker, and it stayed there until the day of his death. And I'm not sure where, I think it's been put in his jar of rocks. I think it's put in his jar of rocks.
It's in a special place. Terry took care of it.
Okay, yeah. So it's going to live on. Mm-hmm. But yeah, we love Don. We love Don tremendously. He's been such a close friend to both of us.
That's great. Someone else? Judy. That's okay. Take your time. You know, that's why we put a microphone down here, because it would take Don a long time to get to the microphone. So we wanted one handy for him.
Everyone loved, obviously. It was a birthday party for Kelly and Sue out in the vestibule. And two young men, homeless, I believe, wandered in. They saw us eating and having cake and pizza. And instead of Don saying, well, who are you? Get out. What did he say?
Welcome home.
And I'll never forget it. It just touched my heart. And I saw what a wonderful, kind man he still is. And that's how it should be, Christians. Not get out, we don't know you. They were hungry, and he welcomed them. That's it.
I love it. I love it. I remember that. Special. Yep. Thank you. Yeah, Don, another Don. I heard about this Don before I even met him from our Don. Said, do you know Don down at the Baptist Church? He can sing too.
And that's what drew Don and me together, was the fact that anytime churches within the community of Lincoln City would gather together, we'd look at each other and say, where are you going to sit? I'm going to sit beside you. And we would harmonize and just love worshiping our Lord together. But one time we had I can't remember what the program was, but it was here at your church. And Don looked at me and he said, oh, my prayers have been answered. You're going to heaven. You're here with the Nazarenes.
Pretty good for a Baptist. Oh, we love our Baptist brothers and sisters. Yes. That's great. Thank you, Don. Somebody else? Cal and then Elaine. Yes.
It's an honor to be here to honor Don. I'm not a member of this church for good reason. When we first came here, before Kelly came two or three times, there were three different pastors, so I needed a pastor, so we had to move on. But every time I came back with the church members and Don and the rest of the congregation members, always welcomed Barbara and I when we came. And one of the memorable times that I had with Don was they needed a Sunday school teacher part-time or to fill in, and so I did. And I was surprised because there are other people who are well to do that project. Anyway, I was teaching about the names of God. It's how wonderful things that God is. He's strong, he's a creative person, he's a merciful God, he's a loving God, a graceful God. And I had some other names going along the line, sub-names and primary names of God. And Don came up to me and said, "You know, I didn't know there were so many names of God." So it's kind of nice to know that I caught him off guard once, but most of the time he was Don Crow.
Hi, I'm Elaine Deem, and Uncle Don became my uncle 40 years ago when I married Rod. But about 42 years ago, I started with the Purdom family reunion here at the coast. So before your dad and your grandpa moved up here, we used to have these family reunions, and Teresa's mama and daddy got a house up here. What's the name of that little town? Nesquin. And they would all come. Aunt Dolores and Uncle Don come up from Arizona, and they'd bring little Susie Q. She was just Susie Q to me. And I was a teenager, and she was just tiny, tiny tot. But one of my greatest memories about that was getting to know Don and Dolores, because they were in Arizona, and we were in Idaho. So we never got to really see them. So this was a great opportunity. In this house, there'd be about 30 to 40 people in a three-bedroom house right on the cliffs. There's no yard. We're like packed in there like sardines, right? So much fun. But Uncle Don, anybody remember him with a sweet tooth? So we'd have to do shopping for all these people for this week that we would have the house. And he would be going, slipping a 20. I need the candy. I need the candy. So we would go to the store, and I'd have money from Uncle Don just for candy. Started with a 20. I'd come back with what $20 would buy then. It was quite a bit of candy then. Not enough. I'd get 40 the next time we went to the store. And it would get bigger and bigger. I'm like, should you have this much candy? Yes. We need this much candy. And it was just one of those moments, right? And they hadn't moved up here yet. And then when he retired and moved to the coast, and Bob and Grace were here at the coast too, it became a time where we could spend longer periods of time together. And then Rod and I moved down into Portland, and then we were out on a regular basis and had a lot of amazing time together. And my children, it's their great Uncle Don. They got to know him and truly grow with him, because he's really the only great uncle that they had. So I'm just so blessed. And candy and coffee, right? Had to have a cup of coffee. He was just that joy for us.
He wasn't a diabetic at all. Yes, he was. anybody else? Pastor Johnny. Welcome home.
That's what I will say. God brought me and my family almost 2 years ago. And we didn't know anyone, and we don't have family here. The first Sunday that Pastor Kelly brought us here to this church, Don was there with a cup of coffee. He saw us, and he said, "Love, welcome home." And I remember that day. He was a great man who was always willing to serve and love anyone. Every time I had the opportunity to preach or serve with the music or with my kid, he supported us. He says, "Great job, good job, good." And we was practicing, he was singing with us all the time. He was with us singing. So it was a blessing to know him, and it's a blessing for me to have him on my memories.
Pretty special. Anybody else? Be brave. Somebody always tells me after we're done, "Oh, I wish I would have come and shared." Carlina, here she comes.
I just have a little bit to say. I got welcomed in the church the same way. He said, "Welcome home," to me. And their family kind of took my family in when it was a really rough time. And I went on a vacation, and I went with Sue, and she was trying on clothes, and I was sitting next to Don, and Dolores was on the other side, and he looked over at me, and he said, "Take good care of my girls." He didn't say Sue, he said, "Take care of my girls," and I just thought it was kind of funny at the time, and I didn't really think much about it. She tried on some other outfits, and, you know, he approved on some and some did not. It was funny. And even on the ship, we would get ready at night and we'd say, "Hey, is this dad approved, do you think?" And we'd make jokes about it. And we came home, and I told him, "You know, yeah, I got your girls." I said, "Well, you know, take care of each other. We're on the trip." And I just think it was such a blessing that I got to go with her. And I met him, and that's not what I was going to say.
Thank you. Anybody else? I know it's hard. Huh? Oh, yes.
Wonderful. Very hard.
I'm Paula Harger. Thanks. Uncle Don was my mom's brother. And there was six in their family, and at least three or four families had eight kids, and the other had six and four. So when the Crows had a reunion, it was huge, and we used to have a lot of fun. And I see a lot of my cousins here, and it's just great to see them. But Uncle Don lived, we all lived in Cuna, Idaho, and Uncle Don lived in Arizona. And from my understanding, he would get a loan every year. Is that right, Terry? That makes me cry, because it's just, those times were so special to us. But he would get alone, and they would jump in their pickup with the camper, and I'm guessing all you boys rode in the back and Sue in front with Mom and Dad, because she was special.
Baby girl.
Yeah, she was the baby. And they would come, and we would sleep outside under the stars and talk all night and have a lot of fun. But those were special times. Family was extremely important to Uncle Don. And I loved getting Uncle Don's hugs. You know, he'd just wrap his arms around, "How's my girl?" And I just, those were special memories. And I'm going to miss him. I know we're all going to miss him, but I just wanted to share how special it was to have the Crow family come to Idaho to visit the rest of us. Anyway.
Thank you. Someone else. All right.
So my name is Jake Hanks. Paula just spoke. She's my wife. But I felt a lot of love from the whole Crow family and the Harger family, which that's my wife's line. But Don was a good guy. We'd talk periodically on the phone when he was talking to my wife Paula. Paula and I have been married 40 years. I got to. But I got to see a lot of Don's siblings. It's surprising how fast time gets away from us. Mm-hmm. So, thank you.
All right, Cheryl. Don would love it when you'd come to the coast. Yes, in your beach house just down the street, huh? I'm Cheryl Six, and yes, we did. The Lord blessed us many years ago, my siblings and I, with a house just right down the street. And this is our home church when we're not in Salem Home Church or Arizona Home Church. Don, wow, I could just... So many couples welcomed us and encouraged us and was always genuinely happy that we were here and part. We did different services, some game nights, lots, some dinners, volunteerism, not family, but I'm part of Don's family. Because I'm in God's family. I thank the Lord for the opportunity that I had to be part of Don's, just a little bit of his life. The welcome home, the hugs, the harmony. He, not every week, because I wasn't here every week, but he would come in, and I mean, when I would come in, he often had a song, and we would harmonize for three or four measures. Special memories. Was sad to hear of his death, but so thankful of his homecoming.
Thank you, Cheryl. Here comes Grace. I think Don at this point would sing Grace, Grace, God's Grace.
Well, I'm Dolores' sister. And when she was 17, and I was just right behind her, and this Don came into our lives, and she found Don and fell in love with him and got married at 17. And she moved to Arizona, away from the big little sister. But we went and saw the relatives and the friends, and we just so glad. We lived those apart. We lived in Idaho, and she in Arizona. We retired. There's two houses between us for our older age. And so just love Don and Doris and Sue and then her brothers. And I'm very blessed to be in this family. And I want to thank this church. They have been so good, bringing food and things. Thank you all so much. We appreciate it.
Wonderful. Anybody else? Dave.
So I am up here representing those people on Facebook that are watching live right now. And if you don't know it, our Facebook page, Lincoln City Church of the Nazarene, has a live feed. And then afterwards, we will copy this live feed, and it'll be available under LC Church on YouTube. But three people, Dee Moon, who was lives here in the community, says that she remembers Don's smile and his greeting. Debbie Rohrbach, who is a new visitor to our church, she's back in Tennessee right now, comes back and forth. She remembers, and she says, she first of all wants to tell Terry, wherever Terry is, that Terry, she says she loves your shirt. She specifically said that on there. And she's sorry for your loss for your brother, for Don. And the third one is Hope Pileski. She's related to the family somehow?
No, she is a Spanish coordinator.
Okay. Yes. She says thank you, and she's sorry for your loss.
Great.
Wonderful. We've got a lot of people watching live online. Hello, we love you. Yes, anybody else want to come and share?
My name is Daniel Crow. Grandpa Don, he moved away when we were younger. We didn't see him as much. But I feel like he could charm the shirt off someone in a very cold storm. Wherever we're at, whatever restaurant was, he's always kind of just giving the waitress, the waiter a hard time. And if it wasn't for, you know, his profession, he could have been probably pretty good in sales. I can't remember where we're at, but we're renting a car. And I said, well, what would you like? And he said, well, my son drives a Dodge. My wife drives a Dodge. I drive a Dodge. My daughter drives a Dodge. You know what? I'm going to take the Dodge. I don't know what if Jesus allows automobiles in heaven, but if he does, I know what make and model you probably chose. What's pretty special is I didn't realize how faithful Grandpa Don was, and hearing the stories from you guys here, it's absolutely amazing and very special, and I'm glad his lineage can live on and spread the good news of being saved by Jesus Christ. We miss you, Don. We love you. Thanks, everyone, for showing up.
Yeah, thank you. Awesome. Anybody else? Oh, Penny and Ariel. I love it.
I was 13 years old when I found this church for my mom. And I remember walking in and being like, there's a lot of old people here. I was terrified. And I didn't know how I was going to fit in. But I remember walking in and Dawn gave me this biggest smile and said, welcome home, you belong here. Even though me being a teenager growing up, I would always miss church because I didn't want to come. Every time I would come and appear, he goes, how have you been? I've missed seeing your face. He was like a grandpa that I didn't have because my only one was all the way in Medford. He was so welcoming to me, and he helped me in so many ways. And when I had this little one, He looked right at her and said, "I'm so glad to be your grandpa." And every day she would run up to him and give him the biggest smile, to the even point where she wanted to come share right now.
Thank you, Ariel. So special. We love our kids. Yeah, anybody else?
I don't know what to say, but recently, I don't know what to say, really. Yeah. I didn't know I kind of didn't know what I believed. and but, you know, ask, yeah, and I did, and one thing, it's kind of crazy, but it says enter into his presence with singing, so I thought, my Aunt Mary gave me a hymn book, and I didn't ever use it. I just carried it around with me. But I started, I read, and I said, I can't sing this. That's not true. But anyway, and then, but then little things come to my mind. Yeah, the Spirit and the Bride say, "Come," you know, and Jesus said, "Come." My sister said, just everything, talk to Jesus about it. And I try, but I think God, he said, the Spirit and the Bride say, "Come," and, you know, we can't understand people, nobody, me either, myself, I don't understand myself, but it's just come and keep on coming, and I appreciate that welcome home. And you know, sometimes we can lose people, and it's, but the Spirit and the Bride still say come, and thank you for this service.
Thank you. Anybody else?
I can't come up there, but I could share this with you. I have to apologize to Don now for what I said. But we picked him up and he had fallen, and he looked really, really awful. And he was just black and blue everywhere. And I was thinking of the worship team, and they had been talking about how he looked at everything. And I looked over him. And I looked at him and I said, I looked to him, "You look terrible." He says, "I know, thank you."
His face was black and blue, and Pat said, "You look terrible," and he read her lips. And he says, "I know." Yep. Good memories. Anybody else? I don't want anybody to regret it. Rod. Hot Rod, here he comes.
Oh, everybody. So I'm Rod. That's Uncle Don to me. And we had big families, big family reunions, and we had great family, and everybody was nice. But Uncle Don always would come up to me and grab my hand and look at me with a big smile and say, "How you doing, little brother?" And the last time I saw him, guess what he did? Took my hand, pulled me over. "How you doing, little brother?" So, love my Uncle Don.
He'd say that to your dad, too, every week. "How you doing, little brother?" Anybody else? Linda.
Well, my heart is rejoicing for Don today. He has achieved the greatest desire of his heart. He is with his beloved Savior. Okay. And now heaven is a brighter, if that's possible, and even happier place because Don is there. He is so alive, friends. He's more alive than he's ever been. He's in perfect health. His body's whole and healed. He's the most perfect version of himself that God originally intended. And eventually, we will all enjoy that wonderful blessing. Don is, and I say is, because as I said, we know he's more alive now than he's ever been. He is one of the most loving, gentle, kind examples of a man of God that I have ever known. And Don, we're going to be up there, and we're going to be waiting and to have you there greeting us and say to us, "Welcome home, family of God. Thank you, Jesus."
Amen. Anybody else? All right, will you close with me in prayer? Lord Jesus, we are so thankful to have known Don Crow. Lord, we're so thankful for all that he meant to us. And Lord, I am so thankful for each one gathered here today and those watching online. Lord, I'm so thankful we have some more minutes to share stories and all the fun things we did with Don, Lord. Lord, I pray that our lives may be enriched by his life, that our lives may somehow be changed, that we become a little more like Don, who was a lot like you. Lord, thank you so much for this time where we can celebrate his life and remember him with fondness in our hearts. Lord, would you just go with each of us today in a special way, having our lives changed because we've met with you as we've remembered Don. And we love you, Jesus, and it's in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Well, we want to invite all of you to join us for some treats out in the foyer. And yes, and family, go see Cheryl today. She has a special announcement for you. So God bless you all.
Chairs and move them away. So if you hear somebody yell, make a hole, just work around and get the chairs.